not have the SAP. The prior problems that we had with our past medical provider, Medico has provided an answer to most of all those. Medico has provided a comprehensive 200-page policy to nurses versus a 20-page manual used by the previous provider, ensuring each inmate receives appropriate individualized care. Medico has implemented medical screenings of every inmate at the time of admission versus only screening those identified with immediate need by the detention staff. Medico has provided 100% staffing since the beginning of the contract as agreed in the contract, staffing matrix, never leaving the facility without a medical staff being present. Besides that, Medico has provided outstanding services to Randolph County Detention Center and makes great strides to implement cost-saving measures for Randolph County. Medico has been an excellent partner in our fight to keep COVID-19 out of the detention center. Medico has strived to meet every contractual obligation. Medico liaisons are currently working with the county IT to implement paperless systems to ensure medical records are accurate and safely stored. Medico has developed an excellent partnership with Daymark to provide on-site mental health services to inmates. Medico responds promptly to inmate medical needs and conducts evaluations and treatments to meet the individual needs of the inmates. Medico stepped in to provide health care with very little notice after SHP abruptly ended our contract. Medico has provided never-before medical services at the jail, such as telepsych services and medication-assisted treatment for substance abusers. Medico has worked collaboratively with Daymark to provide wraparound services to inmates addressing both mental health and substance abuse. Medico has offered triage and medical treatments at the jail instead of sending inmates to the emergency department. Medico has taken the initiative to give Medicaid benefits for inmates who need costly outside medical services, which alleviates the county of the entire financial burden. Three Medico nurses and a doctor who worked for the previous provider now feel much more empowered and capable of providing for the inmate health care needs due to their leadership, guidance, and protocols established by Medico. Medico is recommended to continue providing inmate medical health care at the Randolph County Detention Center. My opinion that keeping Medico as our inmate health care provider would be the most prudent decision in light of the current pandemic. We have successful protocols in place that have proven effective in keeping the virus out of the detention center. Based on the level of service received, I believe the cost difference in keeping Medico versus contracting with another provider will actually be a cost savings when compared to medical bills paid outside of the cost pool with another provider. Medico has already saved Randolph County almost $90,000 in inmate health care costs since January 2020. I believe that the additional cost in contracting with Medico is a worthy investment to protect the county from liability. And if you have any questions concerning the how Medico has been a blessing to our detention center, we'll be more than happy to try to answer those.
I want to say that I've heard they have a very comprehensive training program when they started, and even invited it to Marshall by the health department, and not every medical provider wants to work with the health department. So for us to know that our health department is well received and is seen as a partner, is viewed as a partner, they take
This is Megan King, and it was very nice of her to drive down from Virginia to be here.
Sure, I know. By watching my videos, one of the questions every morning is, what's going on with the jail? Still called the jail. And as I was mentioned, we haven't had a case there yet, and somebody's doing something right. When we know that these things break out, where there's groups of people so close together. But I know Health Department, Susan speaks highly of this group. And Susan, I know you come in today when we talk about this issue of a difference that goes on with this group versus former.
Yeah. I would like to say that we have just been really, really pleased with Medico. Prior to that, we couldn't hardly get a phone call return to us when we had issues that we needed to talk with the medical staff at the jail. And we were invited to come in. The physician owner did the training. It was extremely thorough. My director of nursing and I were there. Since then, their staff, the nursing staff at the detention center has been involved with things we've done. They were at our town hall meeting when we began our sharing information about COVID-19. They call us and ask us questions regularly. That never happened before. If we had somebody that had a communicable disease there, we had to beg to get the information that we needed to fix the problem. That's not been the case with Medico. So we are extremely pleased. Being on the outside looking in, I think they've done a fabulous job, and we really appreciate the work that they're doing.
Thank you.
I also like hearing about the relationship with Daymar and getting, mental support and work with mental health and substance abuse issues. It's important as commissioners, we always think about saving money. And so it's wonderful to hear about, you get Medicaid benefits for people and, saving money in those ways. But ultimately, I like knowing that our inmates are getting good care because they are people that need a second chance. And if we can provide good care for them, it might help them to take advantage of that. We just never know, and that's why we do what we do. So I think it's a good call.
Brooke, can you give us a little more breakdown on these cost numbers for the trip? On the comparisons, I think you have that little schedule there. I know the contract is, it's more than what we put there. Yes, I mentioned these other benefits, but help us with the numbers just a little bit.
Yeah, well, if you look at page 4, as the sheriff was referring to, SHP's comparison, we were paying a population increase. So what Medico had worked with us on was adjusting that ADP rate. With SHP, it was at 211 and it was locked. We couldn't change that whatsoever. However, with Medico, they were able to change that to 230 to 275. So that was very beneficial. So we hadn't incurred any cost. So any transition over that limit, we hadn't incurred any cost whatsoever. The cost pool breakdown is a little bit different for this year because it was prorated beginning at the end of October. Looking at your safekeeper cost, which I think would be the confusing part of it. So safekeeper is run by the Department of Corrections, and that's pretty much an inmate medical hospital. So if you look at those costs on there, Medico's been helping us out tremendously. Last year we had a large number hit us from safekeeper. But as opposed to this year, as the sheriff was referring to, they have had up to a savings of $90,000. And I just got done speaking with Lisa Stevens, who is in their finance department with Medico, and she's looking to also help us with a rather large amount from Safekeeper. So not only are they helping us with our existing numbers, we're solely through Medicaid, they're going to help us apply for Medicaid for certain inmates, which is just astounding because we've never had that before. I've never seen a credit from a medical provider before until we started working with Medicaid. As far as the other costs, I guess the medical provisions pretty much stay the same, but one thing Medicaid has done tremendously is they're trying to keep as many people as they can as a Safekeeper, and that's really just comes down to communication with the nurses as well as our patient staff.
So what you're doing here is trying to get an apples to apples over the same period of time.
Correct, sir.
So in that analysis, there's a $16,000 positive variance when you compare it the same timeline.
Correct, sir. The smaller difference would be actually the cost pool limitation because it was looked at 8 months as opposed to 12 months. But I mean, overall, even with that limitation, they've still been able to save us a tremendous amount of money, as the sheriff said earlier.
I guess we're looking at this quality correctional health care as a guy. I guess how much say the difference is that they've done a good job for us, and part of it is the quality of care and not knowing what this other provider might or might not provide equitably.
Correct. And I mean, you know, we feel great about Medicaid, what they were able to do. This same group of looking at the quality correctional healthcare, they had an opportunity to come in, but Medicaid was the one that really stepped up in the end. And we feel like that means a lot to us as well as the county commissioners and county citizens. That the cost is different, but we don't know what's on the other side. We know what we have right now, and we feel comfortable and safe with that.
So they can always invite try to buy the business a little bit then on the back side, nickel and dime.
Yeah.
I'm not saying that. That could be, you know, a time when you contract, you download all the first year and make it on that second year. Yeah, I mean, if y'all are comfortable with that, I think it's, sounds like they've done a good job, especially keeping the COVID-19 out of the patient facility for a lot of folks. Can I say that? And also,
with getting the rapid test in, which is something in Minnesota. And that's been something that helped get it. If we can get this machine, medical is willing to not have to take the test themselves, the nurse is willing, and they will provide quotes. And that's an old addition, that is, get the machine, we'll do the test, and we can not do it, and the nurse will do the test. Right there, Chip.
One of the issues that this is beneficial, we have law enforcement in our municipalities, are still around on Liberty. They might make an arrest at 2 o'clock in the morning. This is part of keeping COVID-19 out of the jail. They weren't tested before they put them in there.
Yes, sir. We have a questionnaire.
We have some problems.
Yes, sir. We have a questionnaire to go through, and if they have counsel, yes, to some of the questions and everything, and the temperature, and they get around somebody else, and then they have to test it. They need to be tested, or have to test it, even at home.
So what's the protocol? Yes. What do you do with that? So if they answer positively to any of these questions or picture, what do you have to do now?
We're at this time, we're taking them to the hospital, and with a little pressure, they will correct tests, but there's been a having some pressure when we get to the end.
And if the Duke said that, or I guess answer negative some of those questions, and we have to admit, we have an area where we can put them, keep them away from the children online. So we will keep them away from the general population if we have to incarcerate them.
Can I ask a question? Can you give me a kind of synopsis on when you talk about they're helping with your Medicaid money stuff? When they save you Medicaid money, does that save the county, you're saying? Because the county gets that Medicaid money, they help find it, but they help the county with not having to spend as much as that. I want to make sure we're putting them in that part too.
Yeah, just kind of an idea. So our former provider, what happens is when inmates come in and Medicaid, as far as our rep provider, they go ahead and search to see if they can apply for Medicaid. That way, if they have any drastic expenses, Medicaid will go ahead and take care of it. For instance, as the sheriff was saying earlier, that's what they do. So instead of saving us $86,000, we would spend $86,000 in county funds. So, yes.
Has everybody been talking about the problem? Yes,
sir. Yes, sir.
Well, and just as an example, last year, during our last budget, we actually had incurred a bill of $130,000 from a safety work in May, so at the very end of the fiscal year. Now, looking back at that, that person could have been, possibly would have been eligible for Medicare, or Medicaid, but the previous provider was not looking for any ways to help us with the bill, so it's been very valuable to us.
So would this money, would the money to pay for the machine come from CARES fund?
Yeah, I think that's right, yes.
Good. That's perfect.
Yes.
Okay.
Any other questions? All right. What's the pleasure of the board?
I make a motion that we approve the renewal of the contract with Medicaid in the amount of
we're glad you're there. I'm glad you are there.
executive committee, which is made up of myself, vice chair, Dan Kim Moffitt, and Luke Collinsworth, along with the support of our board, we have worked very closely these last 3 months with our staff, Amber Scarlett and Amber Renee, team to develop a plan and to work to try to navigate this unprecedented time. It's been challenging. But these two ladies that I mentioned, Amber Scarlett and Amber Skeen, they deserve the credit for keeping it between the lines, keeping us on track. These ladies have been amazing these last few months. They have spent much of their time researching our services, our contracts, to see where we could save money and cut expenses. They have had the burden of furloughing our staff because we knew that was not going to be feasible right now with what was going on. And all the time that this was going on, they continued to pick up numerous phone calls coming in with questions about Randolph County. They continued to mail out collateral materials and also create virtual opportunities to keep Randolph County showcased and everything we have to offer. So when we do come back to that new normal and people are coming back and getting out a little bit, we want them to know what's here. So, you know, all these things that they did so we can leverage our fund balance for it to extend it and make it last and go as far as we could. So at this time, I'm going to turn it over to our interim CEO, Amber Scarlett, and I'd like to share with you a few details regarding the request that we have to use.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, Mr. Vice Chair, Member of the Board, thank you for your time this evening. I come to you on behalf of the Randolph County Tourism Development Authority Board of Directors with a request to waive the annual administrative fee of 2.5% of our projected 2019-2020 budget year, as defined in our contract with Randolph County. Our projected expenditures for 2019-2020 budget year were set at $1.1 million. However, our lodging tax collections have fallen quite short of this projection. Recently, the tourism industry has directly been affected by COVID-19 and has experienced a drastic downturn in revenues. Randolph County has seen significant declines in lodging tax collections following Governor Cooper's Executive Order 135 and extension of Executive Order 121 issued in the state law order. This executive order resulted in travel across the state of North Carolina coming to a halt. Our attractions and museums in the heart of North Carolina closed. Our dining establishments shifted their business models to takeout services only. Our shops were supported solely by online sales, and our events were postponed or sadly canceled. Our destination marketing and promotion efforts have continued with a different tone and message, one of virtual support, with weekly social media marketing that would limit the minimal cost to our organization. Our revenues for March through June, of course I don't have June, but I do have something to look at to compare for 2019. Revenues for March 2020 were reported at $36,106 in comparison to March 2019 of $69,152. Revenues for April 2020 were reported to date at $17,697, compared to April 2019 revenues of $98,100. The entire month of April fell into the stay-at-home order, and we also saw the cancellation of the High Point Furniture Market, the strongest revenue collection for our Archdale area hotels during that time. We also found one property in Archdale completely closed on April 3rd, and to date has not reopened for business. Collections are still in process for May 2020. However, our May 2019 revenues were reported at $127,877, and the stay-at-home order was extended into the first week of May, with travelers slowly finding their comfort level as we make every effort to create safe environments for them to experience. Our June revenues for 2019 were reported at $94,088. To list some of our savings, as my chairman mentioned before, we have been successful in the reduction of our expenditures since mid-March, with plans to continue into 2021. We've received some deferments and forgiveness for operations and advertising costs through this budget year. Personnel savings have been $6,500 per month through the elimination of one part-time employee and placing two of our full-time employees on furlough leave in 30-day increments. Our operational savings have been $5,000 per month by reducing operational costs of office supplies, postage, printing, utilities, and travel expenses. Our marketing savings have been estimated to be $5,000 per month by a reduction of advertising lives and renegotiating contracts, halting sponsorships for events, halting assistance with print publications such as maps and brochures, and placing special municipality project assistance on hold. Despite these savings, we have still needed to utilize our fund balance monthly to sustain our expenses. We've slowly taken steps into phase two of the recovery strategy and are seeing an uptick in occupancy from our area hotels in Archdale and Ashville. However, we will not meet that $1.1 million budget as previously anticipated. To date, our anchor attraction in North Carolina Zoo remains closed. Several of our Super Lottery community partners will remain closed until phase three, and restrictions are still in place for gathering in large numbers for doing special events to occur. We appreciate the consideration of our request to waive the 2.5% administrative fee from our projected 2019-2020 budget, allowing our fund balance to sustain our organization into the future for the anticipated return of revenues.
Very detailed proportion, but thank you very much.
Thank you.
So, what was the April that would have been? April 2019 when the awards are targeted for market?
April 2019, $98,100. Today, in the Swiss on the future plan, 2020, $17,697. A difference of $8,403.
Of course, like some of you already know, I have the pleasure of working with these folks as one of my community assignments, and I've been just incredibly impressed with the hard work of their executive committee board and whatever to try to whittle things down and be conscientious as well. And of course, everybody are in the whole budget goes from occupancy, all of it. So there's no dollars anywhere else. So just seeing those numbers reduced at April, the best example, you can imagine what that looks like. And does everybody get the part about which I'm going to be talking about, what they're asking for, and what, how that's made, and why that's made? They contract, the board contracts with our finance office to do this task, or whatever it is, the fee. You're doing that, and they're just trying to offset their budget by the fee that we've charged them. So, you want to explain that with numbers, and if everybody exactly what they're asking for?
I notice your statement is a percentage. What roughly dollar figure are you talking about?
It's $27,688 for the 2019-20 budget.
That's the year that's going in June.
Yes, sir.
But our new budget, right?
Our new budget we'll present to you on June 15th. It'll be $700,000. So, of course, the number will be different.
They have worked closely with Suzanne Dale and done an awesome job of cutting our $400,000 out of our new budget that will start July 1st with anticipation of what's going on around us.
But tonight, we just talked about the
team of
it. Yeah.
This just lets up the easy end. Sure. I guess it's how they usually pay that at the end of the year.
Yeah.
Pay it all the time.
We usually transfer it during the year, but I don't know if we have to.
So it's been accrued. All right.
two teams, so we're open to every other center, to keep those staff members separate for their protection, for visitor protection. We have a lot of safety protocols in place. So far, we're seeing that travelers are not necessarily coming in the building, but we have staff members outside handing information back, so they're not coming in at the doors.
So you're one every other day?
Yes, we have two free shifts.
So some workers did not come back?
Some did not come back, but did not have the comfort level to return to work.
Okay. Any other questions? I just continue to be impressed with being an ambulance chairman. But one of the first safety duties, which I'm not always at, that is a dollar rate for me. And just to see the work that they did, like she mentioned, to get that budget down from the past budget to 1.1 and cut out a little before. I know I'm already working to try to reduce this cost because they know we're working with it. You know, all those levels, like trying to figure out how to get random kind of information in people's hands and do that safely, keep everybody safe. You know, so, but thank you for everything to people. Yeah, I'll be glad to make a motion. Let me see what that means.
It always helps. Hey.
Yeah. Hey, yeah. Well, switch for you on that. Yeah, I'll be glad to make a motion to approve waiving the financial administration service fee at 2.5% for manufacturer development expenditure for fiscal year 2019-20. Got a second?
I'll second that.
Motion and second. Further questions or discussion on the motion? Hearing none, those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. And it passes.
Thank you.
Thank you again.
Thank you so much.
So much. I enjoyed the whole lot of stuff too this month. Okay, next is a request from our county health director for a couple of positions.
You should have a memorandum for me requesting the approval of a public health educator position. It's a public health education 1 position. We're asking for this position because during this pandemic, it has become evident that it would be our benefit to have a bilingual health educator. About 64% of our positive cases for coronavirus have been in the Latinx population. And about 64%. The 2010 census says that our Latinx population is about 12%. I think, you know, 2020 census will probably look much different, provided people feel comfortable in you know, answering the questions required in the census. So this is an important position in terms of being able to communicate with people in their own language, understanding their own cultural, you know, intricacies. It just would, I think, you know, knowing someone's beliefs and customs makes a big difference in being able to provide education to them. So we are asking for that position. Do you want me to present both positions at one time, or do you want to take them one at a time?
Go ahead and go.
Okay, the other position is an accounting specialist. One position, this is a position that I have been thinking about for quite some time, and I just never felt like the timing was right. Previously, we had some situations happen in the last month or so that made it very clear to me that our finance unit would function much better if we had an accounting specialist one. We've got a very, very complex budget, probably, for our size, probably one of the most complex budgets. I'm looking at real.
The grant systems.
Yeah, because of all the grant systems that we have. And our due to some issues she needed to work out. And if I had had to do that budget, I would have been in a lot of problems. A lot of y'all would have probably fired me on the spot because I could not do it. Will would have strangled me, I'm sure. So it is very clear to us that it is critical we have someone who understands our complex budget, who understands what we do regularly, and can back up the person who's the lead finance. She's really our finance manager. Can back her up and manage that budget when she is not available. She has taken on our finance unit has grown. When I came, finance pieces were here, there, and gone. And I asked the internal auditor to come in and look at our finance operations. I wasn't happy with the way it was running. I felt like it could be much more effective and efficient. And she came in and she agreed that we needed to make it one unit to put things together in a reasonable fashion. And her recommendation at the time was that we consider having our finance manager that we have now, but she, in the process, she got it. She got a promotion, and a well-deserved promotion. And so, not only was she still doing her job, but that added supervisory responsibilities to her work as well. And so again, we are very complex, we have lots of grants, there's lots of reporting that has to be done. It will be very beneficial to us to have this position, and having this pandemic just made that crystal clear that we need to do this. So I'm asking for that. County specialist in one position in addition to the public health.
Susan, on the county specialist, and you've described this difficulties, what kind of labor market is out there? Is this going to be on the job training, or do you expect to find somebody?
Well, I would hope we would find someone with a finance background. The way this would be advertised is somebody that does have accounting skills, that has worked in a similar kind of setting for, can't remember, 2 or 3 years maybe. So, I mean, it is a complex job. It's not just, you know, there's stuff you have to do. So I would hope that we truly would have someone who would be qualified to come in and do that.
You've also mentioned through this pandemic process and dealing with the protocols that are in place about a PA, a physician assistant.
We have, and we have included that position in, we had a position that we reclassified, I think, if my memory is right, in our new budget. And so we are asking for a position extender position in the new budget. The reason we need that position is because we don't have a physician on staff. And we do contract with a medical director. So they, you know, are there to provide guidance if we need a standing order. Nurses in public health departments can work at a higher level than nurses in a private practice. They receive extended role training. They can do things that other nurses cannot do. And the only way they can do that to work within their scope of practice is to have a standing order by a physician. One of the things that we've run, one of the issues that we've run into or that we'll have is when we do COVID-19 testing now, if we have someone that the health department is going to test, we have to get a standing order, or we have to get an order from a physician to do that. If we had a nurse practitioner or a physician's assistant on staff, it would be that person is going to be able to do those kinds of things for us. Another example is when we do STI, sexually transmitted disease infection, screenings, or when we see actually, she can't see them. The nurse can't. The nurse has the extended role training to see that male, but the nurse can't treat them because she's a nurse. Only a physician or a physician's extended or a nurse practitioner can treat them. So we have an agreement. We send them from our office. They go up to Mercy Clinic, and they get treated up there because they have that capability. It just, in a communicable disease situation like we've been in, it would make it, we would be able to do the things quicker that we need to do than we are now. So going forward, that would be a great benefit to us in the new budget. That position is in the new budget.
So this request is going to be for the current budget? I mean, we're in June right now, so.
I think the way to look at these positions are we're kind of pre-approving them for the 2021 budget. I don't really know whether we're going to get anything hired in this year, but this gets her a head start to get somebody on her staff by July 1st as opposed to waiting to adopt the budget in June and it's another month.
So she's just going to start the search.
She's starting the search right now and get ahead. These two positions will be added to the minutes when we meet on June 25th and add whatever else the board wants to add, and then work out the financing piece of that as well. This just gets over 30 days.
Questions?
Susan, on the accounting specialist, I guess last year this time, everybody was talking about making transformation and things like that. That was put off because of the budget impasse, and now the virus. Would that, and my understanding is that the health department, that's a privatization of Medicaid. So the health department would become almost a, act almost like a compete with these private entities for various services. Would this accounting position impact this?
Yeah. Do you mean will Medicaid transformation impact it?
Will that make it a lot more complex potentially because of the
Yes. Absolutely.
Dealing with the United Healthcare and those folks for various services and also being, I guess, statutory responsible for providing services.
Thank you for reminding me of that, David. Yes. It will make it very much more complex. Because if there are four or five different entities that we are billing, we will have to bill those entities right now as it stood when everything finished. They will have to be billed independently. So we've got one person right now, we just lost one who billed, was one of our billing clerks. She retired. And so right now we've just got the one, and they'll have to bill these Blue Cross Blue Shield United Healthcare. You know, Wellco, all these folks will have to be billed independently. So yes, it will be much more complicated.
And the public health educator, that for the bilingual, that's permanent. It's not just because.
Yes, it will be a full-time permanent. Yes.
Wait. Almost two-thirds of the COVID cases are in the Spanish community. I think that's one of the things I think that in meeting with some of the folks, that's one of the things that's kind of been eye-opener that we may not have that capability to communicate as well as we probably should have, especially in that particular, very localized area.
That's a major issue within industry here.
Yes. And part of that is because of the makeup of Randolph County and the kind of industries that we have. We have work. People go to where the work is. While we've lost a lot of industries, we still really have a fair number of large industries that employ folks like this. So. And the public health educator, having somebody, we've always had, we've had interpreters. Interpreters don't educate, they interpret. You know, so having someone who truly does understand the culture and the belief systems and all those things really does make a difference in how we present the information. So yes, it would be permanent, we'd like to keep on.
Okay. Three or four videos with Spanish.
I think we had three.
Yeah.
That we want to see the sheriff and two.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, other questions?
Would you consider retiring for the county specialist?
Absolutely.
It's like you got somebody down on the end and not having the time on hand.
Yeah. All right.
Well, I make a motion to approve the addition of an accounting assistant, one position to the public health department.
That's special.
Well, that's number C.
Yeah, I'm specialist.
County specialist.
Well, they're both in that same.
Can I do both at one point? And then, for that motion, I also make a motion to approve the addition of public health educator position to the public health department.
Right. Now, motion and second, approve these two additions. And again, a yes or no, you can't do this, we won't fund that or whatever. It's the red word, educational, to hear how each department is has to interact with what's going on with this world right now.
I would remind the board, I think last month there was discussion about adopting a resolution to designate those essential employees. Some of the term work, they can't stay at home, and we didn't do that. And we haven't had employees that stayed home and didn't come to work in this whole thing, maybe a couple. Almost 800 employees, so I think that speaks well of the workforce of this county. And Max has told the Social Services Board, they're going into homes. There's not many people that go in there. And they literally, their lives are online, in a sense. But we didn't have to make employees come to work. And I think that's important for the citizens of this county to know. Some counties now did because they were pressed to do that, but we did. And that's good leadership and our departments and throughout our workforce. Okay, you're going to give us a situation report.
I am. We had a total of, you all should get a copy every day. Tara and our health education supervisor and some of our health educators. Tara is the last stop for our executive summary of our situation report, our daily report. And I want to give some kudos to Tara because she is, we could not do without her. She does a fabulous job and I really appreciate her hard work.
I would say the extended report that you're doing with those other, the averages, I've had lots of folks to compliment and making that out there. It's really helped them to better understand the numbers and make some comparisons, but that was a great addition.
Yeah.
And it's gone noticed, my point is, it's gone noticed in the county.
Yeah. Well, good. We're glad to hear that. Today's case total at 4 o'clock was 678, and that's the total from the beginning of that pandemic. We've got 515 that have been released from isolation. So that doesn't mean that they no longer have, that they're totally recovered. It just means that they've completed their isolations and their symptoms have resolved. Subsided, but they still could have issues going on that they may need care for later on. We've had 13 deaths. We've got 10 hospitalized, so since we met this morning, we've had two more added to that. And we have two nursing home outbreaks. This morning, I was telling you all about Universal Healthcare, who's been dealing with an outbreak. They have 26 total cases. 18 residents, 8 staff, and 3 of those residents are in the hospital. But this morning we had collapsed convalescence nurses. We had one case in a staff member. And about 11 o'clock today, we got a report of another person on their staff who is positive for coronavirus. The state's definition of an outbreak in a nursing home is 2 positive cases, regardless of whether it's staff or patients. So we do have an outbreak, considered an outbreak at Claps. They have 2 staff with positive test results. So we are still doing very well. Our nursing homes have worked extremely hard. We've got one of our communicable disease nurses is dedicated to working with them. She calls them every Monday. She asks for a report on what's going on. She asked for a line list of all staff from their from each of the nursing homes. So we're putting a lot of effort into it, but so are the nursing homes. And they have been out front trying to prevent this before it ever started. So I give a lot of, I mean, just tremendous effort that they have made to try and keep their residents safe, and they've done a great job. Testing, I want to update y'all a little bit about testing in Randolph County. I know if you watch Governor Cooper and Secretary Cohen, when they do their press conferences, you keep hearing this, we're going to ramp up testing, we're going to ramp up testing. And they are. Any provider in Randolph County can go on the state website and say, I want to be a testing site. And it's a one-stop shop. There's a link that can go in and say, LabCorp is my laboratory that I deal with, and I need X number of supplies to be able to provide testing. Or they can say, Quest is my laboratory that I deal with. And they will send them wherever, whatever laboratory they work with, they will make sure that that provider gets whatever testing that supplies they request. So that is fabulous. Right now, they will also do the same thing for personal protective equipment. So they can go on, but you can't do one without the other. They can go on that website and can request personal protective equipment as well. Right now, what we are encouraging folks to do is ask their provider if they are worried that they may have been exposed, or if they have symptoms, or if they were contact to a positive case. We say, please contact your provider. But if they tell us up front that they know the provider is not doing testing, all of our urgent cares, Whiteoak Urgent Care in Randleman, Whiteoak Urgent Care in Ashboro, First Health, Convenient Care in Ashboro, who else? Horizon Internal Medicine is also providing testing, and they are able to do a quick testing at Horizon Internal Medicine.
Mercy
is not right now, but they can go on and request. I think they're very interested. We have polled a lot of the providers around. There were providers up toward Archdale that was interested. So we made sure they know all they have to do is go on this website and make those requests. So hopefully they will be able to do that too. CDS on Dixie Drive started on Friday, being able to provide self-testing. Pull up through the pharmacy window, drive-through window, they will hand you a self-collection kit and the pharmacist will watch you do it. And then you give it back to them and they submit it for testing. So that's available.
How long does that take to get results?
You know, I'm not sure on that one. I know they will bill your insurance, and if you have Medicare or Medicaid, they will bill that as well. But I am not sure how long that one takes. Sure. It's probably, if I had to guess what, you know, LabCorp and Quest and those they were real quick, they were real long in the beginning. Then they kind of got capacity on and they were able to turn things around in about 24 hours. And now we're seeing it to, you know, 24 to 72 hours, just dependent. And I would guess that it's probably like that as well, but I don't know.
So how available or accessible is the rapid test?
They're not real available. One, that as far as I know, the one that is helpful for the detention center, Dr. Hall has it at Horizon Internal Medicine, and the hospital has it. So during the day, if they have an inmate who they're worried about, Horizon Internal Medicine will do that for us. And I say us because we've been working with the jail and trying to make sure we keep them safe, help them stay safe. They've been doing the work, we've just been there helping. At night, the problem is after hours, and that's why they have to go, like at 2 o'clock in the morning, go to the ED and say, will you please test this person? We also heard today that Whiteoak Urgent Care at both locations were doing what they could to try and start doing rapid testing. So hopefully that will expand. And certainly they're up until 8 o'clock at night, I think, and so that would help as well.
Is there a supply of machines, like?
That's a problem. What we know about machines, and like the one that we would like to get from jail, is that those are being pushed toward the hotspot areas. So I know Horizon Internal Medicine has had two of those machines on order since the beginning of March. They've not received them. When they called to check on what the status was, they were told they this is what happens when you're 62 years old and your brain starts falling apart. They're pushing it to another place. So they're going to where all the hotspots are, like Wake County, Mecklenburg County, other places in the United States where they, New York City, you know, Atlanta, other places where there are way more cases. So our ability to get one of those machines will probably be not like we want it to be, but we'll try. We'll see. Hopefully we can. So we know that testing is going up, and that's a good thing. I also mentioned to y'all about contact tracing. And you've been here in the state, I think, talk about that as well. They have collaborated they have a partnership right now with Community Care of North Carolina and North Carolina AHEC. And they've come together and created this project called Carolina Community Tracing Collaborative. And it is designed to give every county in North Carolina the number of contact tracers that they need. It's paid for by the state, it doesn't cost them. It is, these individuals work from home, and they do all the training and all the management for these folks. We have been promised 26 contact tracers. Right now, we know that we have vetted 28 individuals who have applied to work in Randolph County. And people who apply, you just put in Community Care, and you put in Carolina Community Tracing Collaborative, and the AHEC website will come up where you can apply for those positions. Now, every county in North Carolina is going to need them. There are a few counties that have decided they're not going to work with CCNC and AHEC on this. We tossed around the idea of doing that ourselves, but when we sat down and really looked at it, it would have been a management nightmare. We would have had to hire 26 people. I would have had to have a manager to train them, manage them during the day. These folks are geared up to do it and can provide all the hardware, all the resources they need. So it was a win-win for the county if we let them do it. And it would have cost us as well. So we are working with them. We should have about 26, 8 of which should be bilingual, because we made that clear that we had to have bilingual contact tracers. Right now we have 5 nurses who are case investigators. We have a nurse manager on each shift, we kind of working shifts. We have 2 case investigators / contact tracers. So when you get a positive case, somebody's got to call them or find them. I've sent nurses out to find these people. We call law enforcement to help us find these people. And for the most part, law enforcement does help us find those. So we are very appreciative of their support. So once we find them, we have to find out who all they've been in contact with. They have to be called. We touch base twice a week. So it can be very labor intensive. So this is going to be a good thing that we're getting this help through the Carolina Community Tracing Collaborative. So that is, yes.
What kind of background do these people have to be able to do this?
They do all of the training. I have not looked at the, I did look at the job class, job description, but I did not look at requirements, but I think they will take anyone with a high school diploma that you have, I mean, there's a 3-day training you go to, and pretty much what you're doing is you're calling and saying, how are you today? Do you have any symptoms? What's your temperature? So they're calling in and monitoring them because they've been contacts to a positive case. So once they, if they say, I'm feeling sick, they would be referred to someone for testing, and then if the test came back positive, we would start that case management. We would do case management. The other part of that is if we call somebody and cannot find them, they were willing to, the Carolina Community Tracing Collaborative was willing to have these folks go out in the field and find people. But these are work from home folks. They may or may not be from Randolph County. I think a lot of ours will be from Randolph County. They may not know our county. So we decided we wanted to be the people to go out and find folks. So we're going to maintain that part of it. But that's.
So if you're unemployed and retired, you can apply.
You could. You could do it.
So actually, you have a total of 10 jobs.
The trick is that. I think these are 40-hour week jobs. So they won't be. They seriously won't be doing this work. I knew a lot of people. We lost a lot of people in the last 2 years to retirement, just at the health department. And I know people who could flat out do this stuff. But it's a 40-hour week position, and so a lot of them are retired. They don't want to work 40 hours anymore.
Rick, I complained to my wife on her property yesterday, and she got on the call and told her that the lady at the desk admitted her and had a virus. Mm-hmm. And she picked up a pen and signed the paper, so she's under 14-day quarantine. In the doctor's office.
Yeah. Well, it happens. Even though you try really hard. Hopefully she'll be fine, because if that was the only contact she had, typically we're looking at contact for, within 6 feet, which they probably would have been, but for 10 minutes or longer. So just quarantine for 14 days might be a nice vacation. Sure, just fine.
Yeah.
So any questions about what's going on right now? We're trying to keep you as up to date as we can on what we know. So, anytime.
Do you have any ideas when these 26 tracers will be available?
Yeah, that is the question. We're not clear on it. April Wilbur, our director of nursing, has been working closely with these folks, and she said she has not gotten a clear date on that yet. We do know they've hired a few, like five so far. So, once they get everybody hired, and trained. So I'm hoping a few that already got hired will get them into training this week, and we'll start hearing from them next week.
No, all of this, none of this goes through our health department.
No, they keep, there's a database that all this data goes into. So we have access to that database. We've trained a number of our staff to use that database, so they can go in and see what's going on. All of our folks that are doing case investigation and contact tracing right now can go in there and use it and know what's going on. So we do have contact people.
All right. Very interesting.
Thank you.
Anybody have another question, Susan? Tara, thank you. Also,
thank you. Thank you all very much. I appreciate it.
Very well. Thank you for.
Okay, Lil. Tell us what to do with money. I'm sorry, excited about this topic. Good evening, Commissioners. Back a couple months ago, the federal government passed the CARES Act in response to the pandemic and this piece of legislation, $2 trillion worth. A lot of that assistance came down directly to large municipalities, large counties, and to the states. The state had determined how they wanted to use it, a lot of money. So it got passed down, and
this is not something that we can just go out and say however we want to. There's some very specific things that have to be up. There's money to be used for. And so we'll talk about areas and what we have to submit plan to the state on how to use the money. So they call it the coronavirus relief fund. It's the piece of the CARES Act where we got the money. We have to use the money. It qualifies for any expenses after March 1st and over December 30th. December 30th, we have to spend any of it or any left. It goes back to the feds. It goes back to the state. As I mentioned, it prohibits the use of
it. Can I go back to the state or the feds?
Well, we got money from the state, so it'll actually stay first and then not do that. And I would assume that if we turn it over a dollar, that they might try to find somebody else to keep it and not give it back to the feds.
What did McAfee deal for gutting, correct? The feds. The other 97 counties got it to the state because of their size. The size is 500,000.
State of North Carolina passed legislation on April 4th to divvy out how they plan to use their allocation. They created a coronavirus relief fund. They set aside $150 million for counties, and ours was a little over $2.5 million. There are reporting requirements as we go along how we spend the money, and originally they wanted a plan to end by June 1st. They extend the deadline to the Treasury, U.S. Treasury, they issue some guidelines. In fact, April, and they revise them just to embed it in the revised one. The state said, well, we'll give folks a little time to refine the plan. There's another $150 million that the state has put in reserve if Congress allows these funds to use revenue replacement. So we've got to sort them out for direct costs, and there might be a chance that Congress agrees to it to be able to use these funds for direct replacement. But right now, that is not law. So one of the categories is medical expenses. And you can use that for testing, you can use it for medical responses or transports. You have to transport up and it's indigent, you could cover the whole cost with these funds. Public health expenses, communication expenses, PPE for health departments, social workers, law enforcement. We want to disinfect some place like the courthouse, detention center, city public areas, including nursing homes. We choose to use our funds for that as well. Payroll expenses, the folks that are dealing with COVID-19. This is where we're probably spending much more money.
Now, do they have to be specifically identified that that's what they do?
Well, we have to identify a lot of folks. There's an assumption, according to the Treasury guidelines, that if you're in public health, if you're in emergency services, that you're considered to be COVID-related. So a lot of what we can do, and I don't know whether we want to fire this stuff or charge to this, but they're part of emergency services. Emergency management, and a lot of health department employees would probably claim those types of costs. So I think most of what we will have in eligible costs will be for payroll related expenses. Again, this is carries from March 1st to the end of the year. Compliance with public health measures, expenses to improve telework capabilities. The CARES Act also created sick pay, here's sick pay if you involve coronavirus, family members need that. So those types of costs. COVID vaccine related costs related to jail. So sanitation, social distancing, anything we would pick up there would be an eligible cost. I do want to say that what we have to be careful about as we're using funds is feds threw some money this direction from the health and services and some health department
these different pots very carefully and maximize overgluing. Some pots are more restricted than others. This one's a little bit more open, but for instance, over time I qualify on this one, but not here. So we just need to be very careful as we evaluate how we're going to charge these out.
Do you have specific direction at this point in time on some of that, or is this going to be one of those learning to go deals?
Well, I think we're going to evaluate it. I think the manager plans to have a subcommittee put together to talk about some of the folks learning that to kind of go through some specifics about how we want to use it. Do we want to use it on X, Y, or Z? What's the better choice? How to spend it? How fast is it going to get it? Who's trying to try to expand it to where it will last? Cover payroll holders. So if it blows over in different factors of our company, you know, they will have it. We won't need it, but it's just part of the plan. And the plan can change as we go along, so it's, we're not really stuck with whatever numbers we have. Then the guidance that says any other health care function related expenses reasonably necessary. So the categories aren't necessarily bad for them, as long as we can justify it's COVID 19 related. So this is the plan that we want to present. And we've just kind of set aside that sort of dollar amounts, pretty nice round numbers that we need to around as we move forward the rest of the summer.
That's a good point. That's a good point. They're not fixed with what you got. They are coming in the program.
Right. What the answer here is to address the problem and not really.
What if you spend more than all we got?
Well, I think if our expenses are more, I don't know if we're going to get any more unless the state gives up that other kind of commitment.
We need to work on the legislative things.
Just to go back and make sure we and the public understands, those three counties got money directly from the feds due to population. North Carolina got $3.5 billion. About 3 weeks ago, the Saturday morning session, they spent about $1.6 billion of that money. That's where our $2.5 billion came from that pot. So they still have almost $2 billion of money in Raleigh that was sent to them for these issues. I think Senator Berger said he would like to see that money held until the current unemployment benefits run out at the end of July. But the state has another $2 billion that was sent for these various things that Will has identified here that has not been distributed. So our $2.5 came from the $1.6 billion that they spent. Every county got a minimum of $150,000.
And then the revenue replacement, that's all COVID expense, so I think there's something else they're working on in the later, whatever version
yes.
is, 5, 6, or whatever.
I mean, how bad do the numbers get so long as it's not there? One of the categories we listed here, the chairman had a meeting, a Zoom meeting with the mayors to let them know that we would set aside a certain amount of these monies to reimburse the municipalities if they had costs related to COVID-19, which is probably PPE, possibly some renovations, a sneeze screen at the lobby area to protect employees and the public. So those kinds of things, we've got some money for them to get reimbursed for. I'll have a sign sent out for that application for reimbursement tomorrow. So what I'm going to recommend tonight is to set aside this money because it has these restrictions, because there's so much reporting and oversight on it, is setting up a coronavirus relief fund, special revenue fund, separate from the general fund. It's going to operate pretty much the way the 911 fund is. It's not part of the general fund, it's restricted, and it's a separate fund. So the resolution that was provided to create this fund We got the money last week, we did come in last week. We don't know how much we're gonna spend in this fiscal year and how much we're spending by December 30th of the next fiscal year. So, it's an annual fund and people, you create it as part of the budget process for next year and we'll carry it over what we need.
And we'll keep us updated on how it's spent. And now, hopefully. Any questions on the resolution?
I have another question, Chairman. I think this is the proper way to do it.
Oh, yes.
I think Guilford, like I said, they got 93 days, they set aside about $1 million for municipalities. We didn't really work with it, and like health department, social services, we're providing that all across the county. But they might have some direct expenses, as we're mentioning, petitions, things like that, in their municipalities that would qualify for reimbursement with this money. They didn't give you money.
Right.
It all came to the county. So we made them aware that what we have, we went over all the restrictions and requirements, and if they have expenses, then we will reimburse that for them.
Well, I'd like to make a motion to establish a special revenue fund for a resolution to establish a coronavirus relief fund.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Thank you. Any other discussion, comments? I think this is important, and thank you, Will, for putting it together. Any other discussion? Those in favor of the motion will say aye.
Aye.
Those no, and it's approved. Thank you. How do you have anything? I don't have any questions. Jeremy, Rodney, thank you, gentlemen, for your service tonight, being with us. Yes. And do you have any instructions, anything for us?
Now, when you folks are ready to go, those of you who park in the judge's parking lot,
okay,
we'll go over with you. There is a crowd forming outside, so it's probably better that whenever you're done, you can wait until that.
All right. Thank you, gentlemen, for your help. Any other questions or comments on this board? That motion for adjournment?
Adjournment.
For adjournment. Thank all of you citizens. Thank you for viewing tonight. And this will be on YouTube.
Yes, sir.
Going forward, so thank you again, and we stand adjourned. Thank you.